I'm ready. Okay. Ladies and gentlemen, it's so nice to see you here tonight. I have actually a really interesting lecture tonight. I spent a certain amount of time preparing, and I think it's good material. It's okay. This is just like at home. But I will say, I was talking to one of my students who's watching these videos from New York State, and he said to me, "Dr. Abramson, you know, I love the lectures." He said really nice things about him. He says he just feels really bad for me because he says nobody ever laughs at my jokes. And I tell him, it's just the microphone, which is facing forward. And all of you, of course, you're on the floor, belly laughs and things like that. But, you know, just for my student, Mr. Newman, when I tell this joke, laugh a little harder, please. And I'll do my part. I went and I got out a joke book, Joseph Kalushkin's Jewish Humor, What the Best Jewish Jokes Say About the Jews, because I realize I'm really using my six jokes over and over and over again, and you're being very polite, so I have to give you a new joke. So this is a joke from page 31, and it goes like this. So Goldstein has been in analysis for 25 years. He's been seeing the same psychiatrist for the longest time, and the psychologist says to him, "You know, Mr. Goldstein, we've had a long relationship, and I feel like it's really time for you to move on. You know, you've been in my office twice a week now for 25 years, showing sight. It's time for you to move on with your life." And Goldstein says, "But I'm not sure I can do that. I mean, you've become a part of my life, my routine, my week. How am I supposed to, like, just separate?" And he says, "Listen, here's my card. I'm going to put my home number on it. Here it is right here. I want you to call me anytime you feel a need. I'm confident that, you know, our relationship and your therapy has been so effective that call me anytime." So sure enough, Sunday morning, 6 a.m., the psychologist gets a call, and the Goldstein says, "Oh, doctor, I had this terrible, terrible nightmare, and I woke up, I couldn't sleep any longer, and I tried to analyze it, and I just can't get to the bottom of it." And he says, "Well, what was the dream?" And he says, "I had this dream that you were my mother." And it was overwhelming. And Goldstein says, "Well, what did you do after that?" He says, "Well, I sat down, I wrote it out, I, you know, used Freudian techniques." He says, "Then what did you do after that?" He says, "Then I had some breakfast." "What did you have for breakfast?" "A bagel." "That you call breakfast?" All right. It's not that funny. It's funny on page 31, but try. Okay, I'm trying, Mr. Newman. Okay. Tonight's lecture is actually a fascinating lecture. I did a little bit new research for this lecture, new for myself at any rate, and I found some interesting things that I think you'll enjoy, and I know that I enjoy doing the research. It's about a woman named Wuhsha the Broker. The first H is a guttural. As Billy Crystal says, Yiddish is basically German with phlegm, so you just have to pronounce Wuhsha, like the Yiddish ches, as it were. And the topic is that for me?
Yeah.
Oh, thank you so much. My daughter gave me a cup of coffee, which is really nice. So it's about Jewish women in the medieval economy, and her life is actually fascinating. We have a few scattered documents about her in the Cairo Geniza, and I'm looking forward to sharing with you what her life says about the life of Jews in the medieval economy. Tonight's lecture is sponsored by the Kula Brothers. We have a good representation of the Kula brothers here, right? We have 80% of them here, which is great. And so, in memory of their parents, I had the schus of knowing Chazan Morton Kula. He was really a very, very special individual who lived in our Kehila. He lived in the Waverly at 92nd and Surfside, and he was a very, very talented and spiritual individual that touched the lives of so many people. And I know this is a little bit of a departure from our tradition, but I wonder if one of the Kula brothers would like to take no more than 30 seconds just to say something about your parents.
That would be nice.
No? Just sure. say one story. Come on up. Get the camera. You know? This will be on YouTube forever.
Right. Right. So my parents were people who were dedicated to loving other human beings. And no matter who they were, where they were in the spectrum of life, they loved knowledge, Torah, they would do anything to keep learning, and they were master teachers, and they always imparted to us and everyone around them that they could make the world a better place. You believed it, and you made it happen. So with that in mind, we look forward to learning tonight, because it shows there's always a future, and the future will be good. So we thank you for your Torah.
So, it's actually, it's not even out of tradition for this shul. It's one of the nicest minhagim they have at this shul is Many people sponsor shalashuddas for a parent who passed away or something like that. And whoever sponsors the shalashuddas usually takes that time, 15 minutes or so, just to tell stories about their parent. And it's really quite moving. But let's move along. So who was the amazing Wuhsha? We know about her solely from the documentation that comes from the Cairo Geniza. I will take a few moments to describe what that treasure trove of documents is, just so you can place it in context, those of you who have maybe haven't attended before. But basically, she is a woman who lived in the late 11th and early 20th century in Cairo. 12th century, what did I say? Late 11th, early 12th century in Cairo. Right? This is actually an authentic picture from the Cairo Geniza. We don't know how they invented photography 700 years before Europe got it, but I just picked that photograph off the web. Obviously, we don't know what she looked like. Actually, we have a sense of what she looked like. You'll see by the end of the lecture what she probably looked like. At any rate, she was a woman of phenomenal wealth, hugely wealthy woman, hugely charitable woman at the same time, really an exceptional woman, and her very exceptionality says a lot about the nature of women in the economy at that time. She also was likely never married. The sources indicate that no evidence of a husband, but she did bear a child out of wedlock, also not so usual for an extremely prominent woman. But as we shall see, the social insult that she suffered as a result of her personal dalliance did not in any way impugn her sense of responsibility to the community, and she continued to give tzedakah even to those institutions that were most egregious in their ostracism of her for her life. So what I'd like to do tonight is I'm going to have kind of an overview of women in the medieval economy. There's a lot to say there in terms of the Torah and the reality, and these are not always the same thing, as we shall see shortly. I'd also like to spend a little bit of time getting into the deeper elements of historiography. Tonight we have Ms. Herman, who is a senior in the history program at Touro with us, and she's got to take this course next semester where we'll get into historiography, what that is, so we'll touch on it a little bit. And then I'd like to focus specifically on the three key documents that survived regarding Wuhsha's life from the Cairo Geniza. One is a court document in which she was ordered to appear before the court regarding a very small debt, and she behaved in a rather imperious manner, which is quite unusual, you'd think, for a woman of the age. The second is her last will and testament, which is a brilliant document to give us so much insight into both her personal life and the overall structure of women's roles in the economy. And thirdly, a very fascinating document that was used to establish the paternity of her illegitimate son. And so these three documents allow us to give us kind of a triangulation of her life, a GPS, or a GWS, I guess. No, that's not funny. And we'll see a lot about women in the economy and this exceptional woman in particular. So let's get started. One of the most difficult things about studying social history, meaning as opposed to the lives of the kings and as opposed to the lives of the great religious figures and the wars and so on, social history looks at how people actually lived. Or as Herder put it, wie es eigentlich gewesen war, how it actually was for people. How do people actually live? And one of the massive lacunae we have in our sources is, where are the women? The vast majority of people who create the documents from which history is understood were men. And men tended to write mainly about things that were important to men, like medieval, baseball, politics. No, okay. I don't know. I'm funny mood. It's because I picked up the joke book. I'm looking forward to reading it. But men tend to write about other men and about things that are important to men. Women had less access to education. They tended to be far less literate. And they left far less of a literary record for us to create the kind of archaeological finds that would tell us about what their lives were like. So the only way we can really get access to women's lives for much of human history is to try to reconstruct their lives out of what men say about them. And that's just one of the challenges of working in this discipline, is trying to understand a vacuum from, you know, how that vacuum affects the outside world, so to speak. So we have two basic types of information that we'll use today, two types of sources that will inform our discussion. The first is traditional rabbinic literature. That is pious literature, sometimes legal, sometimes philosophical, that is written by, you know, rabbis, obviously, who are trying to promote a particular religious agenda, trying to promote greater attachment to the values of Judaism and so on. And their reflection on women and the roles of women are often idealized and kind of placed in a utopian view that may not conform to reality. The other type of sort, and we'll be looking, for example, at the Mishneh Torah, one of the classic works of the great Maimonides, who writes down very hard-nosed legislation about how men and women should comport themselves with each other, which often, you know, was kind of stating an ideal without necessarily reflecting what women actually did. We'll also look at the Sefer Hasidim, which we talked about a couple of weeks ago when we looked at Yehuda HaChassid. It's one interesting reference in there because it's very rich in terms of folk literature. The second major source that we have for the lives of women are social and economic documentation. Things like, for example, the find of the Cairo Geniza. I apologize for those of you who have been here in previous classes where we talked about this all-important treasure trove of documentation, but basically, the Geniza was a storehouse of documents that was kept in a particular synagogue not too far from Cairo. The Ben Ezra Synagogue, and you can see here, this is actually the doorway to the Geniza. It was up on a second floor, in a kind of an attic, into a crawl space. I have another recreation later on in this lecture where it shows people actually putting things in the Geniza in period costume. But Geniza stored, normally Genizas store any holy writings. Obviously a Sefer Torah, Chumashim, we have, for example, in the Cairo Geniza, actual autographs of Maimonides himself, all kinds of fantastic things like that. But what made this Geniza unique is that the people of this small town believed that anything written in Hebrew belonged in the Geniza. So they anything written in Hebrew letters, actually. So even if it was written in the Judeo-Arabic language, you know, very common statements, business contracts, personal correspondence. We know, for example, that Maimonides had a sister because one of her letters to her illustrious brother was found in the Cairo Geniza. Love letters, poems, shopping lists, honey, pick up some hummus on the way home from the shuk, you know, things like that. That's in the Cairo Geniza because anything written in Hebrew letters was stored away. Then, as a result of some interesting circumstances, the Geniza was shut up for approximately 600 years. No one went in there, and then it was reopened at the end of the 19th century, and scholars discovered approximately 250,000 documents, which dwarfs every other source for the Mediterranean basin, covering approximately the year 900 to about the year 1550. An incredible trove of information that scholars are still poring over in three major universities around the world. Now, in the Cairo Geniza, we have all kinds of documentation that people were loath to throw away, such as, for example, marriage contracts, ketubot. There are thousands of marriage contracts. And unlike the ones that people generally use today, maybe I shouldn't say that. People do personalize them. But there are lots of unique stipulations made in marriage contracts. It was not just the standard Aramaic text. People would add in, you know, and if he yells at her, then she has to give him two chickens or whatever. They would add in all kinds of details. So we know a lot about their social lives from this documentation. And finally, one last element of social literature is the so-called responsa literature, which is a genre that still persists to this day. And it goes back to the Gaonic period in the 8th century, where petitioners will ask rabbis questions in Jewish law and practice. And the questions themselves are lost, they're not preserved, but the answers of the rabbis are preserved and often, you know, collected and reprinted and recopied to serve as precedent in Jewish law. So the types of responsa that we have reflect the kind of problems that average people experienced, and this is the rabbinic attempt to address them. So with these two major types of sources, both the rabbinic literature, the formal literature, like the codes of Jewish law and so on, and the social literature, like the detritus of people's correspondence with each other, as well as the response literature. With these things, we can sort of fix who this woman Wuhsha was and what women were doing in the economy as a whole. Okay. Any questions or arguments to this point? Did I tell you the joke about the Hadassah and Margate that bought the F-15 for the Israeli army?
Yes.
I did. Well, Judith, you've been to all my classes, so forgive me if I say this one over again. This is a good one. I'll tell very quickly. So this, the Hadassah and Margate, they get together and they raise $2 billion to buy the latest jet fighter for the Israeli army. And they purchase it, and they have a big ceremony at Fort Lauderdale Airport where they have the bleachers set up, and all the members of the Hadassah group are sitting on the bleachers, and the pilot, you know, gets out, and he with his helmet under his arm, he salutes the women, he gets into the cockpit, pulls down the cowling, and then fires up these massive jet engines and shoots down the runway and then stops. You remember, right? Then he turns it around, he fires up the engine, shoots down the runway and stops. And he does this a few times until finally he taxis up to the bleachers again, he opens up the cowling, and he says, "Ladies, the plane will not take off. We have to remove some of the plaques." Okay. Now, I'm going to be painting with very broad strokes tonight because we're speaking about the medieval economy, which we're talking about, you know, 700 years of history. So it's going to be fairly rough in many areas. But one major distinction that we have to be aware of is that, with the exception of Spain, which is always unusual since it was that triangular society with both Christians and Muslims and Jews all interacting, the vast majority of Europe was either Muslim or Christian. Muslims, of course, conquered all of North Africa and the Middle East, heading out to Persia and then further, but we're going to really leave it at the like Caucasus Mountains. And the Christians were in control of Europe. And they had very, very different relationships to Jews, and the lives of women were similarly different whether they were in a Christian land or in a Muslim land. And a couple of factors really should be borne in mind. One of the factors is that Jewish women in Muslim lands suffered under a far more repressive standard of living vis-a-vis their activity in the public sphere. For example, Maimonides writes in the Codes of Jewish Law that it's appropriate for women to go out maybe twice a month, meaning go out of their home maybe twice a month. Otherwise, they should really be living totally in the home. And this is not at all the kind of standard you see with Rashi writing in France, for example, or Germany. So Maimonides is reflecting a social reality where, even though there's nothing in the Torah that would specifically say a woman has to stay in home, there is definitely some encouragement of the private sphere and its association with women, but the idea that she would be restricted to the home was really not at all a value that Jews had in Christian Europe, but it was one that they absorbed in Muslim North Africa. Ironically, at the same time, Muslim law has a couple of leniencies that are not present in Jewish law, and women would take a veil of these leniencies to their benefit. Even though Muslim society tended to be somewhat more repressive in terms of women's activity in the public sphere, Muslim law gave women a little bit more control over their own income within marriage. And as we shall see, women often exploited this dichotomy between what Jewish law allowed and what Muslim law tolerated for their own benefit, and the rabbis were forced to simply go along with it. And in fact, it was affirmed by several important rabbis, including the Radbaz, saying that, look, this is the custom of the people in which they live. The women have more rights over this income, and therefore we should respect the custom of the Jews living there. And the last thing that's kind of relevant is that after 1492, with the Spanish expulsion, and then shortly thereafter the Portuguese expulsion, then you have this unusual mixture of all of these very educated and much more cosmopolitan Jews in coming in large numbers out of Spain and Portugal and populating many of the important cities of the region. Istanbul, for example, North Africa, ports in Greece and so on. So that also changes a lot of the intellectual dynamic as many of them come into contact with customs that they were not familiar with at all. So that's a really important thing to bear in mind. I'm going to be speaking in gross generalities, but I can't go on without discussing that. Let's return to this concept of this public sphere. Judaism, like Islam, definitely promotes the notion of the woman's dignity being located within the sphere of the home. It's related to this concept of tzniut, or tznius, which means basically, it's often translated as modesty, but a better translation, a more close translation, would be hiddenness, the value of remaining hidden, of not standing out. Like, for example, the metaphor of the Torah scroll, the holiest object in a synagogue. The Torah scroll is not simply left out on display for everybody to watch. It's, you know, within its own mantle, and it's behind a curtain, inside a box, behind another curtain. Because of its value, it is hidden away and only taken out under very restrictive and highly protocol-infused situations. So this is a metaphor for the value of tzniut, and it is associated more with the feminine than with the masculine in much of rabbinic literature. Yes, Ms. Abramson.
I'm not so sure if that's a good metaphor, because if you look at the Aron Lehrer, that's like the main part of the entire shul, and it stands out from the rest of the shul.
Ah, good. Excellent observation. I see you're headed for greatness. The Aron, the ark, does stand out. But the Aron is there as a protection for the Torah scroll.
Then why would we make it stand out? We don't want to make it like small and thin.
Okay, let's move on to the next question, okay? No, I think that's the idea, is you have to put it somewhere, right? I mean, and in many you know, could hide it in the closet, but you know, in many it has to have a place of dignity as well. I mean, you know it's there, but it should be dignified, covered up, and so on. That's the notion of it. So what this meant for women in Muslim lands in particular is that they had very little opportunity to engage in business outside their home. We will see that especially after the 12th century, there is a relative explosion of women in that area willy-nilly. There are women involved in commerce and so on, but it is definitely considered a lower status activity for a woman to be involved in, you know, public haggling in the marketplace. On the contrary, the kinds of professions that women especially chose in the Muslim world were associated with the textile industry. And it's important for us to bear in mind, particularly because we live in the post-industrial revolution, where we have one of the hugest, most huge, is hugest a word, Mr. Rodriguez? No. One of the largest, one of the largest, one of the most significant changes in women's reality after the industrialization is that they were freed from the incredibly burdensome task of making clothing, which, don't forget, began with the raw wool or the flax. And it was a hugely time-consuming a task to process that flax or that wool into thread and then make that thread into cloth and then tailor that cloth into clothing. It took hours and hours of an average woman's day to do this. And so this was a task that needed to be done, and it was considered kind of an ideal job for women. Maimonides even explicitly states that spinning, that is taking the raw wool and making it into thread, right? It says in Eshet Chayil we say it, kappa, what does that say? Oh, and now you have to say it from the beginning because it's an acrostic, an aleph base, and I forget. It's Yodea Shilcha B'Kishor, how does it go? Yodea Shilcha B'Kishor. Now I sound like an idiot. I can't remember it. V'Nasata? Kapeh Tamchu Falech, right? Her hands grab the palech. And what's the next part of the verse? And then something afterwards. The palech is the part, I think it's called the distaff, that holds the wool, right? And the other part that she's holding, the second part of the pasuk, is the other end with the thread. And nowadays, I've tried it many times in my classes, none of the women in my classes ever know what a distaff is. They've never even heard of it. And yet, for the vast majority of human history, women would grow up from the earliest age that they could balance, they would be holding on to these things because it took up so much women's energy. Yes?
When you described women's role, wouldn't that retrograde to the age of Hyle, because there she was went out and did business and negotiated, and here you're saying that women were not allowed to do it, so that was a retrograde step, surely.
Excellent, excellent point. I think retrograde is an excellent word. I'm definitely going to use it a few times this week because it sounds very intelligent. And, you know, I once took a personality test, and it specifically told me that I like using big words because it makes me feel
big.
Je ne sais quoi. Yeah. But, no, but I think you're absolutely right. If you look at Eshes Chayil as a description of the ideal biblical woman, she's out there in real estate. She's got ships coming and going. She's in international commerce. She employs all kinds of people. Meanwhile, what is her husband doing?
He's
sitting at the gates. You know, what's he doing? Sitting around at the gates. And she's doing all the work. Let's return to this because it will be very relevant. The reality is that women were still very involved in all kinds of activities, including simply going out into the street and engaging in the marketplace. Here's a text from Europe, from the Rhineland, the Sefer Chassidim we talked about 2 weeks ago. And here's an amazing little piece of folk history you can read about what it would be like for women. A woman who is traveling, first of all, there's a woman traveling, presumably on her own, heard that a group of Gentiles was approaching her and she feared they might rape her. In such a case, rules the Sefer Chassidim, she is permitted to dress in nun's clothing so that they will think she is a nun and not attack her sexually. That's an amazing thing. I mean, the woman's traveling alone, and she can dress in nun's clothing. It would be a tremendous prohibition in many other areas, but it gives you a sense of what must have been like for women to engage in business like that. And if a woman traveling hears that a group of Jewish ruffians, this is like mind-boggling, is approaching her, and presumably the Jewish ruffians would not be put off by a woman in a nun's costume. I can't believe this. She is permitted to dress a non-Jewish dress and say she is a Gentile. Right? Saying, I'm not Jewish. You may not rape me because I'm not Jewish. And then she may warn them that she will cry out and report them, and she may also cry out at once in order that Gentiles will come to help her, even if they kill the Jewish ruffians. I mean, just this one passage from this book, 13th century book, gives you a whole bizarre outlook of what must life have been like for Jewish businesswomen at the time. But let us return to some of the gender-related aspects of it. And perhaps the most significant economic step in a woman's life is the institution of marriage. So economically, it was hugely balanced in favor of the male. In fact, the term that the Talmud uses for marriage is kinyan, which means to acquire. It can't be understood in the same way of acquiring chattel. I think that's a distortion of Talmudic thought, but it definitely is a one-way relationship. The husband, as it were, acquires a wife. The wife allows herself to be acquired. She may not be acquired without her permission, so to speak. She may not be married against her will. And in fact, women have, in some degrees, far more autonomy than men on a level of personal status. For example, in Jewish law, a Jewish man may be enslaved. A Jewish woman may not be enslaved. It is illegal to hold her as a slave once she reaches the age of majority, 12 years old. Before that is a different story, but at 12 years old and on, she may not be enslaved. So when it comes to marriage, there's property that goes from the woman into the marriage, and the woman's family, and property that goes into the family from the husband. The woman contributes a dowry, obviously with her parents' help, and the dowry is far larger than anything that the husband brings into the marriage. The dowry is kind of like, to look at it cynically, it's kind of an incentive for marriage. Last year we spoke about Glückel of Hameln, and this amazing 17th century woman writes 70 notebooks of her own reflections, and I would say at least 30% of them are worrying about marrying off her children, and in particular collecting the dowries and having enough dowry to attract this kind of a mate and so on and so forth. But it's a really big deal how much money or property, it could be, you know, real estate, it could be things like linens and bedclothes, things like that, a woman will bring into the marriage. The bridegroom, on the other hand, gives three gifts. The first is the unofficial yet mandatory prenuptial gift, which today would be something like an engagement ring. It's not actually a sign of marriage, but it is a token of
intent.
Yeah, I'm tempted to say it's a deposit, but that really doesn't sound right. It's like, but it's really, he has to give some object. It's a gift. It's far less in value than the dowry. And then there is the marriage price, which is the actual gift given typically to the parents of the bride for the marriage. Again, it's a small thing compared to the dowry. And finally, there is the so-called delayed installment, which is really the promise of a gift in the case of divorce or the death of the husband. That by entering into this marriage, should the marriage be dissolved, then the husband or his estate, because it devolves on his heirs, would have to pay the wife or ex-wife a large sum of money. And this is intended as a deterrent to divorce and also a reasonable protection that's put in place for the woman. A so-called pilegesh, or a concubine, is essentially a wife, and concubines up until the 11th century were still permitted, and in Sephardic lands, really up until the 20th century. A concubine is a full wife in every respect, except she does not have the protection of the delayed installment, the divorce penalty. So these things really favor the husband because, you know, he can acquire not only a spouse and a life partner and all those things, but he also acquires a big chunk of money in the form of the dowry. The woman may also bring into the marriage property from her father's estate, for example, and under certain circumstances, she may retain ownership of that property. But in traditional Talmudic law, she does not retain the right to control that property or to gather the interest from that property. So let's say, for example, her father gives her a field. The husband can't sell the field. It belongs to her. But he has the right to decide whether to plant corn on it or build a hotel on it or whatever he wants, and he keeps the income from that. That's, you know, traditional Talmudic law. Finally, and this is perhaps the most difficult thing, I've had a lot of arguments with my 14-year-old son who's learning this right now, and he's like, he's a real feminist. He won't let me go on anything. Ma'aseh yadeha, the work of her hands. A woman is expected, not demanded, but a woman is expected to work in marriage and to earn some income. That income is controlled by the husband. Yeah, well, yeah, I have my own daughter listening to this here. So this is the economics of marriage, at least as per traditional law. Now, as I mentioned earlier, there is Torah and there is reality. There's the difference sometimes between what the rabbis say the way it's supposed to be and historically and socially what people did anyway. As I'm sure we see around us even today, you know, the rabbi says some things, and people do a totally different thing if they so desire. And we shall see that the way actually it's built into the very structure of halacha, if enough people sort of vote with their feet, the rabbis have to catch up to social pressures. And the rabbis on many occasions, including rabbis as prominent as Rav Yosef Karo, the author of the Shulchan Aruch, they will validate practices that are not in harmony with traditional statements of the Talmud, if that is the minhag hamakom, the custom of the community, and what the circumstances under which a woman would be married. So, for example, let's just skip to this thing here. So what do we see from the Geniza period? First of all, the Geniza documents, as opposed to the rabbinic documents, indicate that women, yes, they're working, and you know what? They're not letting their husbands control the income. They're refusing to let their husbands, over and over again. It is one of the most common causes of domestic dispute recorded in the Geniza. You know, these cases come to court, and the husband says one thing, and the wife says another thing, and the court has to decide what they're going to do. quite often husbands complain that their wives are making money and they're not declaring it properly. You know, like they're making $100 a week and they're saying, I made $50 a week, and what happens to the other $50? You know, it's like a massive mahjong game every 3 weeks or something. But so we have husbands complaining that their wives are hiding their income from them and controlling it willy-nilly. Secondly, we find wives telling their husbands, hey, sweetheart, if you insist on taking my paycheck, then I'm going to go to the Muslim courts. Because the Muslim courts, as we mentioned earlier, were far more lenient with regards to woman's control of her own income. And this was considered, to use the Latin term, ashanda, if a woman would take her case to the Muslim courts, where she would be vindicated. And that would be a humiliation for the Jewish family, for the husband, and even for the rabbinic courts. So in many cases, rabbis would counsel their parishioners, the husbands, you know, just let her have it, you know. And this became kind of enshrined in practice. Dowries as well, as opposed to maaseyadeha, the work of her hands. Dowries were often a cause of dispute because, you know, her father would give her a certain amount of money into the marriage, and the husband would want to, you know, sell a piece of property, which he's only allowed to do with her permission. She refuses to allow it, and they have a dispute over it. And ultimately, overwhelmingly, says S.D. Goitein, the premier scholar of the Geniza treasures, that the rabbis overwhelmingly gave in to the wife's demands. And they simply said, let the wife control the dowry whenever they had these kinds of disputes. Fascinating kind of dichotomy between what the codes say and what people do. Yes, please.
Is there any mention of why the women didn't want to give the men the money? Was there a problem ever of men drinking or wasting the money and the women?
Drinking in Muslim lands would be difficult. No. I don't know how much they would do. I don't even know if it would be legal. But there's lots, it's hard to imagine reasons. I mean, hard not to imagine reasons. I can give you one right now here. Let me jump ahead a little bit. Like, for example, one case that came actually before Maimonides, shortly before his death. This case goes on that a man goes on a long business trip, 4 years, and he's gone on business. And he does not leave anything for his wife to support herself and her children. So what the wife does is she takes a job teaching Torah, which is also an interesting thing. Here's a woman teaching Torah in her brother's yeshiva. So here she is teaching apparently even Talmud, but that's not clear from the sources. Anyway, so she's an independent woman teaching, and her husband shows up. Hi, honey, I'm home. And he says, you're what? My wife is walking through the streets every day to yeshiva and then teaching boys? Dospashnish, that's how they say it in Arabic. And you have to quit this job. Forget it. And she says, what are you talking about? I love being a career woman, you know? I can have it all, and I don't want to let, I don't get this job. So the husband goes to Maimonides and says that my wife is a moredes. My wife is a rebellious woman, and I want to coerce her to leave this job, or I'm going to divorce her. And the halacha is, if a woman is considered a moredet, a rebellious woman, then she loses her ketubah payment. So in other words, he could divorce her and not have to pay the delayed instrument. So Maimonides says, wow, you know, taka. He didn't say taka. My grandfather always would say taka. But he says, you know, I don't know what they say in Arabic for taka. It's such an impoverished language. How could they possibly speak without saying taka? So the husband, Maimonides says, I guess I have to agree with you. Then the wife comes and saying, what are you saying? You know, did you know that my husband left me for 4 years with no income whatsoever? And he expects me to just, what am I supposed to do, beg? And in Talmudic law, for a woman to beg is a far more serious thing for a man to beg. Men are almost expected to beg if they have to, but the Talmud goes to great lengths to prevent the indignity of begging for women. So anyways, Rambam, when he hears this, the woman's side, he says, you know, you are absolutely right. And he takes back his psak, and he says, you can keep your job, and you're not considered a moredet. If your husband wants to divorce you, he has to pay you the full payment. So he reaffirms everything that the woman said. And that's like kind of an example, perhaps, of what they're fighting about with the money. I don't have any other specifics but it's an interesting question. I refer you to Goitein's massive work, a huge magnum opus, I think it's 7 volumes in length, called A Mediterranean Society, in which he spent his entire life analyzing these documents, and there's a huge trove of information there. So let me just get to what kind of work are they doing. This, by the way, this is the palech, and I forget what the other thing over here that she would have. Here's a woman spinning, right, making the thread. So what kind of work were women typically involved in? Goitein identifies 7 different classes of laborers, labor that women were engaged in. The most significant, the largest one was textiles, as I mentioned. You also see a significant number of small-scale commerce. You see a small amount of trades. In Christian Europe, you see a lot more trades, especially silversmithing. That's, you know, metalworking, and especially working with silver. You know, all of our Kiddush cups and Bechers and things like that, that comes from a very long tradition of Jews working with silver. And in some cases, Jewish women were even allowed to join medieval guilds, which is truly an amazing thing. Women were also involved in money lending, which I'm going to explore in the next 2 slides, and also some in professions. Jewish women working as midwives, as doctors, professional mourners. You could hire women to mourn at your, not your funeral, but someone else's funeral, because, you know, they just set the tone, you know, with the that kind of, those strange things they say, and clapping and stuff like that. Women as fortune tellers, psychics, all kinds of things like that. Jewish women were engaged in these occupations. The Geniza tells all. The Geniza describes all these different things that Jewish women were involved in, and it really is a very rich economy as a whole. Yes?
You said that, you know, they wouldn't be, in a Muslim society, they wouldn't be drinking of alcohol, but what about making kiddush and stuff? After all, this is a very long tradition.
So that's a great question. I don't know if Jews were allowed alcohol in Muslim societies or not. I know that in Saudi Arabia, the American army can't have Budweiser.
I know that.
And that's, I don't know what we're doing
what
there.
What a terrible thing.
Right. In countries like Iran, they allow the Christians and sometimes Jews. I think even the Jews to have alcohol.
So maybe that makes sense. Yeah. Maybe that's...
Because I had Muslim teachers, and they would tell me that's where they would buy alcohol from was Jews.
That's great. Where's that great influence on society there?
Okay.
That in Iran, Jews and Christians were allowed to, I guess, produce and sell alcohol and consume alcohol. Okay, so let's talk for a second about usury, because it's impossible to talk about Jews in the medieval economy without talking about usury, which is kind of like the nasty term for money lending. And Jews were very involved in money lending. It was one of the most important professions, particularly in Christian Europe, because Christians developed this canon law called the Law of Gratian, which prohibited Christians from charging interest on loans to other Christians, which basically shut down the medieval economy, because in an agricultural society where you have an ebb and flow of income and expense, it's very hard, you know, to ride out the year when you're waiting for your harvest to grow. The Jews were the only minority for about 500 years who were legally allowed to lend money on interest. At one point, the Italian Christians said, this is ridiculous, there's so much money to be made, and they ignored the Law of Gratian, and then it broke open and they forgot about it. But for about 500 years, Jews were the only source of credit in the medieval world. Yes, Etty.
Wasn't it the Jewish law also that you're not allowed to lend money to Jews?
Correct. So Jewish, it was,
yeah,
where they get the idea.
Okay.
Jews are not allowed to charge interest to other Jews. I've tried calling MasterCard and Visa to see who the CEO is. They won't answer my calls. But the idea is Jews are allowed to charge to non-Jews, and vice versa. I mean, theoretically, Christians could charge interest to Jews, but the market differential is so huge that it was not profitable. So we'll skip over that. Here's a picture, by the way, of a Jewish moneylender. This is, I think, 14th century Germany. He's got Hebrew on the hem of his robe here, at least what the Christian artists thought Hebrew looked like. He's got a big bag of money. Here's a nobleman with an empty purse asking for money. And does anyone recognize this thing on his desk here?
Is that like
an abacus?
Yes, yeah. An abacus. Yeah, it's a very primitive Apple computer with the, you know, that would be for calculation. So Jews actually really enjoyed practicing usury because although there are some risks, like for example, there's a risk of non-payment, mm-hmm. to a large degree that risk was moderated by the fact that the king relied on the taxes that Jews paid for moneylending, and the king would lend his own enforcement to make sure that debts were paid. The only time it was really dangerous was if the debts became so large that the king would feel it was more expedient to simply sacrifice the debt and get rid of the Jews, as happened several times. York in 1290, for example, yes. where in France they expelled the Jews three times mm-hmm. in one century because they, you know, they owed them too much money, so they kicked them out. Then they realized they wanted credit again, so they brought them back in. They owed them a lot of money, so they kicked them out three times in, I think it was the 14th century. And there's sometimes the risk of violence, and sometimes there's always probably the risk of popular resentment. As you can see from this woodcut, here's a rather penniless Christian nobleman. You can tell that he's Christian because he's bareheaded, and you can see that he's penniless because he doesn't even have a pair of pants. And that's a joke, these are like hose. Okay. Here's the Jewish moneylender again with the bag here, and this gesture, the finger pointing, in medieval art, it's like this is an aggressive gesture. It's usually a pedagogic gesture, like I'm teaching you something, and this would be perceived as a very kind of, you know, corrosive relationship. But the benefits were huge. If you were in money lending, first of all, this is an urban profession. It allows Jews to live in close confines. Jews are a very gregarious people. They like to live within walking distance of synagogue, of the ritual bath, the Chinese restaurant, so it's very hard to live far away. It's a clean profession. It does not involve digging in the dirt for potatoes. It's one that you do with your mind as opposed to with your back. It's a portable profession. It deals with cash. So if the environment becomes a little too difficult for Jews, it's very easy to pick up and move someplace else. And it allows time for study. You know, if you're a banker, you can set banker's hours, and you can spend the rest of the time learning Talmud. So in other words, Judith, did I, banker's hours, that shouldn't lose people, right? That's like 10 to 3. Do you remember that time? When banks used to be open like that, 10 to 3?
Sure.
Now they drive through banks. That's amazing.
24-hour banks.
One kind of misconception, it's kind of an apologetic that was developed when Jewish historiography began in the 19th century, that the reason Jews engaged in this distasteful occupation was because they were prohibited from owning land. That's partially true, but it really misses the point. In many areas, Jews were allowed to own land, first of all, but much more important is the fact that this was a much better profession. Owning land meant that you could be expelled, and then where was your investment? It was gone. Right? If you had something liquid that you could transfer, then it allowed for Jews to move from place to place, and it had all these other benefits. So the Jews didn't want to be farmers. The Jews did not want to, you know, maybe buying and selling real estate, that's something different. But to be a farmer, it's not really a Jewish value, at least in the medieval period. And the apologetic to say, oh, the reason we were moneylenders is because we couldn't farm like all those other farmers, that's kind of an idea that develops out of the late 19th century with socialist ideas that farming is the most natural and healthy occupation and so on, but it really doesn't conform to historical reality. Yes, Judith.
I was just going to say that you touched upon a very important point I thought about not owning land, was that to own land, you were usually living outside of your community. Not the American model where you put the house in the middle of the property, but the fact of the matter was that you were also usually going out away from the community, and you couldn't do your daily prayers.
Absolutely.
And more importantly, you were more vulnerable to attacks because it was such a lonely occupation.
Absolutely. So it's very rare that you find Jews engaged in agriculture. I think from Russia, which I know best, in 1897 there were like 3% of Jews listed agriculture as their occupation, which is incredible. There were, I don't know. Okay, so let's look at Wuhsha for the remaining time we have. Wuhsha, let's return to her specific lifestyle. And we're going to look at three specific documents. I actually have this 1967 article here from Goitein himself, in which he first revealed this woman that he discovered in the Geniza to the rest of the world. And the three documents that I'm going to share with you, the first is this record of a small claims dispute. The second is her last will and testament. And third, this unusual document that was used to prove the paternity of her illegitimate son. So, and this is, you know, it's a brilliant history. This is how history is really done. We'd never heard of this woman before, and Goitein comes across these tiny scraps of paper and pieces them together and creates a picture of who this woman was. So here is the only document which is actually dated, April 19th, 1098 in the Western calendar. And the document reads as follows. On the same day, Mr. Ula Halevi, son of Joseph, presented Mr. David, son of the late Judge Yair, to the court. And the latter witnessed for the former that he was in the synagogue on Wednesday the 10th of this month when Karima, the daughter of Amar, known as Wuhsha, I'll tell you about what these names mean in a second, the broker, appeared in the synagogue and said to him and to Moses, the teacher, the Malamed, and to Mali HaKohen, the brother of the sexton, the Shamus. Okay, so what's happening? This document is some kind of court document, and this person is testifying that he was in shul, and this woman comes into shul, and she talks to these two other named individuals, so they can testify to the validity of the story, and she says, I want to see the Dayan, I want to see the judge, for I was informed that he summoned me. Meaning she shows up in shul because the judge, the Dayan, religious judge, called for her to appear. Now, for what reason did he do this to me? You can hear even the translation kind of like, what does he want from me? You know, like, there's not a lot of, like, self-abnegation coming out of this document. One of those present answered her, because Ula Halevi appealed against you to the president of the court, the Av Beit Din, meaning this guy is suing you, wherefore he sent after you, asking you to appear with him before the court. Meaning this other guy is summoning her to appear in court over a dispute. But you refrained from appearing with him in court, meaning she ignored an earlier summons. So now she's called to the carpet. Hey, how come you didn't show up when we called you to court? And thus you deserved a public notification and a warning. Said she, and I heard it. I mean, I love the way it reads. It's like, you're not going to believe this. She actually said this. What do I owe Mr. Ula that he should make such a claim against me? All that is due to him from me is 5 kirats, which, as I'll tell you later, basically works out to about $20. All she wants from me is $20, 1967. Well, actually, it's $10. He calls me to court over $20. For 5 kirats, he makes such a fuss. At the same time, also Mali, the brother of the sexton, was present and made the same deposition as the aforementioned David. We have written down what has been said before us and have signed so that it may serve as a document conveying rights and as a proof. So what do you make of this just quick, you know, vision of who this person is? What do you think, Judith? You work with these documents all the time.
Well, first of all, it sounds like you have is something like a court reporting, some kind of somebody that's writing this for preservation purposes. But I find it interesting in that there's no mention of oaths. There is no mention of whether or not the judge, the Dayan, was even present.
Right, it just happened like in the anteroom or something.
Something of that nature. But the idea of being called to appear seems to carry with it some kind of stigma.
Yes, I think so. Well, you know, you get summoned to court. You know, someone is suing you, you say, oh, he evades me, right? And if the court says, it sounds to me, I don't know these terms or it sounds like she's being, it sounds like she's being contemptuous of the court.
But more importantly, nobody speaks that they're advocates. There's no advocate for anybody.
Uh-huh.
Where we do know that advocacy was not unknown.
Interesting. That's a perspective I wasn't thinking about. What the kind of things that Goitein points out are fascinating. First of all, her name. Her actual name was Karima, and she's referred to as the daughter of Amar, who is known as the head of the community. Very wealthy and impressive individual. His father apparently was also a very important individual. And she's called Wuhsha, which apparently means, he translates the Arabic, I'm not familiar with the language, That means one without whom one cannot live. It's a kind of an endearment, and people would simply call her Wuhsha, which is meaning, you know, I don't know, mon chéri or something like that. The father, as I mentioned, was a very major leader. He also points out that it's interesting that normally when women are called to court in the documents, there has to be someone there to prove who they are.
Oh, that's interesting.
You know, because women are you know, without identity. Mm. You can't say it's the shopkeeper from such and such a street. You have to say a woman who is the wife of so-and-so, the daughter of so-and-so, and there are people here who testify to that. She doesn't need any independent verification. Everybody knows Wuhsha. Just give her name and that's it. Yes?
Was this a Bet Din?
Well, this is like kind of before the Bet Din.
Okay.
She was called to appear at the Bet Din. We don't know what happened about the 20 bucks or anything. We just have this little piece of documents, like 150, 200 words, and that's all we got. But let's go on to her will, which is fascinating. Okay, so this is her will. The main points of the will of Wuhsha the Broker. She's called the Broker. To my brother shall be given 100 dinars from the objects given to me as a security. Note, by the way, Goitine figures out that 2 dinars was about the monthly income of a middle-class family. So if you take the American median income as that same marker, and that would be about $50,000. If you say white non-Hispanics, it's a little bit higher, for example, $55,000. And so that would mean, if we used $50,000 as a middle-class income, which is kind of hard to believe, but let's say that is, then that would mean her total wealth was 689 dinars, worth about $1.4 million in today's dollars, or looking at it a different way, 28 years of retirement at a middle-class salary. That's probably an easier way to think of it. She could live at a middle-class rate for 28 years on her income alone. On her wealth alone. So, incredibly wealthy person. So, she gives her brother 100 dinars, well as 5 rings, etc. So, to my sister, 50 dinars, as well as a mourning dress and so on. To the daughter of my paternal uncle, 5 dinars, all these family distributions. Then she says, for the cemetery, 25 dinars. For the synagogues in Old Cairo, 20 dinars. Remember, 20 dinars would be the equivalent of about. $50,000, I think. For the synagogues of Damu and New Cairo, 5 dinars for the purchase of oil for study. To the poor of Old Cairo, 20 dinars. To Joseph's wife, 5 dinars. To each of her 2 brothers, 5 dinars. To the orphan girl in Cairo, a relative of mine, 2 dinars. All this shall be paid from the debts against which security has been given. Let me skip a little bit here. The remaining securities shall be added to the cash in gold which I possess, namely 300 dinars, meaning she's got 300 dinars in cash, which is, again, about $500,000 by this calculation, liquid cash, which are ready with me, and the 67 dinars deposited with Lady Ikhtiar, meaning she actually had another woman who held 67 dinars for her. That's interesting itself. In addition to all I possess in cash and kind and rugs and carpets, all this shall be kept for my son on conditions I shall mention. If he remains alive and attains maturity, it shall be handed over to him. If, however, God forbid, death overtakes him before he reaches bar mitzvah, one half of all this shall be given to the synagogues in Old Cairo and the poor in equal halves. The other half shall be divided between my heirs in equal shares, my brother, etc., to his father, the boy's father, Chasun of Ashkelon, she names him, not one penny shall be given. Goitein remarks that he uses a Latin term. This is, I think he calls it verba ispissima, her very own words. You can read, it's her herself, she's writing it, not one penny shall be given, except that 2 promissory notes, meaning that he gave her 2 IOUs, she's holding on to debts from him, concerning a debt of 80 dinars, which he owes me, will be handed over to him. Meaning she'll forgive the 80, she doesn't want his money. Just give him the 80 dinars. And so on and so forth. And then there's a lot of description about her funeral and so on. And then there's a beautiful little description of how she wants her son educated. She clearly loved him dearly and devoted a tremendous amount of money to make sure that her son would get a proper education. And the rest I'm going to skip over. Still, the second big takeaway message we get from this was a colossally wealthy woman with a very charitable heart, and she had an illegitimate son. And she's definitely estranged from the boy's father. And this doesn't sound like your typical Bais Yaakov kind of girl in 12th century. What's going on with it? So let's turn, I'm sorry we're a little bit late. Let's turn to the paternity document, and let's read this, because this is the most fascinating part, I think. So this document was probably written after her death to record an earlier event that was designed specifically when her son wanted to marry, to prove that he was legitimate to marry. Again, I use the term illegitimate. Judaism doesn't recognize illegitimacy per se, except that a child born from a forbidden relationship on a biblical level, for example, a married woman having an extramarital affair or an incestuous affair, would create a child known as a mamzer, which is a terrible stigma. That child would not be allowed to marry anyone else except a mamzer, or a convert who comes with zero yichus, with zero kind of lineage, and then that status would continue for their children as well. So it's a huge stigma. So this document reads, the elder Abu Ala Yafeth, something wrong here, the son of the elder Mashiach, may he rest in Masliach, may he rest in Eden, appeared before us and made the following deposition while we were constituted as a court of three. So another court document, a formal deposition to the court. He said, I was with the cantor, may God accept him with favor, when Wuhsha the broker came in and said, do you not have an advice for me? I had an affair with Chasun and conceived from him. Goitein says the phrase, I had an affair, is really literally, I slept with. I slept with Chasun, and now I'm pregnant. We contracted a marriage before a Muslim notary. Ay Vesmir, it gets worse. She apparently went to a Muslim Qadi and had a civil marriage. So she married this Jewish guy from Ashkelon, and she got pregnant. Why did she get married in a mosque or in a, you know, an office instead of a shul? Goitein presumes that because her lover was a refugee from the Crusader attacks on Ashkelon, perhaps he was already married to a woman in Ashkelon, and the rabbis would not allow him to marry a second wife because there's a ban on that. But the Muslims didn't have such a ban, and so therefore she went. We can only imagine she fell madly in love with this guy, and you know, he hit her up for 80 dinars, so who knows what kind of a guy he is. But she went and she got married to the Muslim. Perhaps they were thinking eventually he'd be able to divorce his wife. Maybe she'd die, then they could have a normal wedding. But at any rate, she got pregnant. But I'm afraid that he may deny being the father of my child. Now, this is a mamzer, right? This is a guy who, well, they're worried that he'll have the baby and he won't say that he's the father. She then lived in the house of whatever on the uppermost floor. So the cantor gives her a piece of advice. This is really Yiddish chachma. He says to her, okay, go and gather some people and let them surprise you with chasun so that your assertion might be confirmed. In other words, she arranged a tryst with her lover, and she arranged for people to interrupt them in fraglante delecto, how do you say that, something like that, so that people would say, aha, they definitely have a relationship, stands to reason that he is the father. She did so, gathering two who surprised her with him and confirmed her assertion. She was then pregnant with this Abu Sa'ad, her son, whom she had conceived in her illicit relationship with Hasun. Now, here's another fascinating thing. I also know the person who's giving testimony says that she went on the Fast of Atonement, Yom Kippur, to the synagogue of the Iraqians, but when the Nasi of blessed memory noticed her, he expelled her from the synagogue. Can you imagine? Because she has this child out of wedlock. She goes on Yom Kippur, and the head of the shul kicks her out of shul. I know this all for sure, and deposit herewith my testimony to this effect. And it goes on a little bit more detail. What is, I think, fascinating about this is that even though she suffered such a huge embarrassment by being driven out of shul on Yom Kippur, if you look at her will, you see that she left a huge amount of money to that very shul that nevertheless denied her services on Yom Kippur. So I apologize for going a little later tonight. The conclusions that I want to present are that we talked a little bit about historiography, about source bias between, you know, the traditional rabbinic formal documents and then the social documents and the responsa that sometimes paint a different picture of the reality of Jewish lives at this time. They portray a very broad swath of Jewish female economic activity, despite the fact that they may have suffered some handicaps as a result of the unique nature of Jewish law. Jewish women were extremely adept at leveraging their circumstances, even if it meant threats of going to Muslim courts, in order to ensure that their economic well-being was satisfied. And we see this specifically in the unfortunate story of Wuhsha the Broker, who endured, you know, personal tragedy and still retained her sense of Jewish responsibility, her sense of Jewish identity, and supported even those causes that sought to deny her dignity. Thank you very much for your attention. I appreciate your extra patience tonight.